Hi there, this is Richard Walker from Lucidate, and welcome to the second part of this fifth video on fine-tuning. In the last video, we looked at Hugging Face pipelines and trainer APIs. Hugging Face pipelines are the highest level APIs for working with large language models. They make it super easy to get up and running with LLMs. In just four lines of code, you can write really sophisticated AI applications, as you can see on your screen. Hugging Face pipelines default a whole bunch of parameters for you, and you can stick with the defaults to get things running quickly. But if you want more control over how your application is going to behave, then you can dig into the documentation and override all of the default settings. It's easy to switch a model in and out. Just supply a model of the correct type with the model parameter. Likewise, and pertinent to what we're discussing in this video, if you want to adapt a model to become more skilled at a particular use case, then you can fine-tune a pre-trained model to improve its performance on your task. In the last video, we used an example of fine-tuning a version of the BERT model. This particular BERT model is based on the transformer model developed by Google. It stands for Bidirectional Encoder Representations from Transformers. The key innovation of BERT is that it's pre-trained on a large corpus of unlabeled text, including the entire English Wikipedia and the book's corpus. For training, it used two unsupervised tasks, masked language modeling, MLM, and next sentence prediction, NSP. The specific BERT model we used in the previous video, named DistilBERT Base Uncased Fine-Tuned SST2 English, is a distilled version of BERT. Distillation is a compression technique in which a smaller model, the student, is trained to reproduce the behavior of a larger model, the teacher. This results in a smaller, faster model that retains most of the performance of the larger model. The DistilBERT model has six transformer blocks, each of which includes a multi-head self-attention layer and feed-forward neural network layer. This is half the number of layers in the original BERT base model, which has 12 transformer blocks. BERT and its variants are mainly used for natural language processing tasks, such as text classification, question answering, named entity recognition, and language inference. The specific model we're using, again the name DistilBERT Base Uncased Fine-Tuned SST2 English, has been fine-tuned for the task of sentiment analysis on the Stanford Sentiment Tree Bank SST2 dataset. Hence the inclusion of a reference to this dataset in the model title. Despite having half the number of layers of the original BERT model, DistilBERT retains 97% of its language understanding capabilities while being 60% faster. This makes it a compelling choice for our NLP task, which is determining the sentiment of movie reviews. We'll compare fine-tuning this DistilBERT model using a regular fine-tuning approach versus low rank adaptation, or LoRA fine-tuning. Before we do that, let's briefly review training of transformer LLMs generally, and then discuss our specific use case. Our use case is a little simpler than the general case, as we shall see. Generally speaking, when we train a transformer large language model, we're training it to predict an output sequence from an input sequence. In this case, we'll train the model to predict the text in blue given the text in green. Before we feed the input sequence into the model, first we need to tokenize it. We split the words into subword tokens and transform the tokens into vectors. We also apply a positional encoding to the tokens to preserve their position in the sequence. This transforms the words into a matrix of floating point numbers. In reality, this matrix will be way larger than the one you see on your screen. Here's a schematic of a general decoder block in an LLM. It has attention heads, a feed-forward layer, and several normalization layers. When we train the model, we take our input sequence matrix and perform a forward pass through the network. This means that our matrix gets multiplied by all of the weights and biases, which are also stored as vectors and matrices in the transformer. After the forward pass, the decoder generates its prediction of the completion, also in the form of a tokenized matrix. This generated sequence is compared to the sequence that we're trying to predict from our test data set. There'll be an error, and this error is backpropagated through the network, and the weights and biases are nudged and tweaked to minimize the cost function that we apply. Now, in our specific use case, we have a movie review and a sentiment score. So we do the same thing again. We tokenize our review, convert it to embeddings, and apply positional encoding. We now have our input tensor for our sequence. This gets run through a forward pass through the network. Our classifier will now outpoint a vector, a 0 and 1 vector. In this specific case, we want our output to be negative. If the output is close to negative, then there'll be very little updating of our weights as the error is backpropagated through the network. However, if our output in this case is close to positive, then the updates to the parameters will be greater. Now we can get a description of all the layers in the network by running the simple code on your screen. If we use the command print brackets model, we get a rich text description of all the model parameters. Here we can see that the vocabulary for this model is made up of just over 30,000 tokens, with an embedding vector size of 768 elements. We can see the 6 transformer blocks with their attention heads and associated feedforward network. This feedforward network has 3 layers. The input and output layers are the same size as the embedding layer, and the hidden layer is 4 times that at a value of 3,072 neurons. This hidden layer factor of 4 is standard practice in many LLMs. Right at the end, you'll see a classification head. The final classifier layer has 2 features, one neuron that fires for negative and one neuron that fires for positive reviews. Now, here's my calculation for the number of parameters in the network. I won't go through the calculation now, but for those interested, please feel free to pause and rewind the video to check my working. The result of this, if I'm correct, is that DistilBERT model has just over 66.1 million parameters. In the last video, we shared the code for fine-tuning our model and comparing the performance of our fine-tuned model to the baseline DistilBERT model. In this video, we want to do another comparison, but now we're going to compare our fine-tuned LoRA model versus a regularly fine-tuned model, and at the same time, show the speed improvements of using LoRA, low rank adaptation. Now, apologies for my code here. While perhaps not the most elegant design, an easy way to do this is to create a subclass of our Lucy Model Trainer class from the last video. We can use the information from our print model function to provide the named layers that we're going to apply the LoRA algorithm to. Conventionally, this technique is applied within the attention heads, and here you can see that I've applied it to the query and value matrices, which actually works great in this scenario. But for other use cases, models and datasets, it's worth experimenting with LoRA adaptation on different layers. Current best practice is to set the alpha value to twice that of the LoRA dimension. But again, feel free to experiment with different values. Now, let's take a look at the results of our experiments comparing the regular fine-tuning and LoRA fine-tuning. We'll start with the table on top, which shows the results for the regularly fine-tuned model. The numbers in parentheses next to each experiment represent the sizes of the training, validation, and test sets, respectively. So, for example, 5K, 1K, 1K, 2 epochs means that the model was trained on 5,000 samples, validated on 1,000 samples, and then tested on 1,000 samples using 2 epochs of training. As we examine the fine-tune results, we can see that the model's performance doesn't seem to improve significantly after 5 or so epochs. This is in line with most fine-tuning results, where a handful of epochs seems to be optimal, unlike training from scratch, where hundreds, maybe thousands, of epochs are required. Now, let's shift our focus to the table below, which presents the results for the LoRA fine-tuned model. The number after LoRA indicates the number of LoRA layers used in the fine-tuning process. For instance, LoRA 4 means 4 LoRA layers were utilized. Comparing the accuracy and other metrics between the regularly fine-tuned and LoRA fine-tuned models, we can see that LoRA achieves very, very similar performance to regular fine-tuning. This is impressive, considering that LoRA only updates a small fraction of the model's parameters. But the real advantage of LoRA becomes apparent when we look at the fine-tuning times. Notice how the LoRA fine-tuning times are consistently shorter than the regular fine-tuning times. This is because LoRA only updates the newly added low-rank matrices while keeping the original model parameters frozen, resulting in faster training. For example, for the experiment with 20,000 training samples and 2 epochs, regular fine-tuning took 802 seconds, while LoRA fine-tuning with 4 layers took 645 seconds. That's a significant reduction in training time without compromising performance. These results demonstrate the power and efficiency of LoRA fine-tuning. By adding just a small number of trainable parameters, LoRA can adapt the model to a specific task while maintaining the model's pre-trained knowledge. This parameter-efficient approach not only saves computational resources, but also allows for faster iterations and experimentation. In conclusion, LoRA fine-tuning proves to be a compelling alternative to regular fine-tuning, offering comparable performance with shorter training times. This makes LoRA an attractive choice for practitioners looking to efficiently adapt large language models to specific tasks or domains. So to recap, in this video, we explored the power and efficiency of LoRA fine-tuning compared to regular fine-tuning. We saw how LoRA achieves comparable performance to regular fine-tuning while only updating a small fraction of the model's parameters. This parameter-efficient approach not only saves computational resources, but also allows for faster iterations and experimentation. By examining the experiment's results, we observe that LoRA fine-tuning consistently outperformed regular fine-tuning in terms of training time without compromising accuracy and other performance metrics. We encourage you to explore LoRA fine-tuning further and consider applying it to your own projects. By leveraging this technique, you can save valuable time and resources while still achieving impressive results. The code using this video is available in the GitHub repo shown on your screen. In the next video, we'll dive into an exciting application of LoRA fine-tuning. We'll show you how to apply LoRA to your own datasets to teach the language model how to write code or interact with a set of APIs. This will open up a world of possibilities for creating engaging visualizations and building powerful applications. So stay tuned for upcoming videos and get ready to take your skills to the next level. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel for more valuable content. Leave a comment below and let us know what you think about LoRA fine-tuning and what other topics you'd like us to cover in future videos. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.